Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.
So let me open Visual Studio. Okay, so if you're seeing this Visual Studio, so how do we declare? I want to declare a variable called marks. So I want to declare a variable called marks, which is an array of type integer. So how do we declare in C#? And this will have around six subjects. So now I want to declare an array whose name is marks and whose size is 6. So how do we declare in C#? So I got from Sandhya one response, and I'm expecting response from others. I want to declare, I got response from Padmini. So how about others? How to declare an array of size 6 and of type integer and variable name marks? How do you declare an array? So I want to see the answers from others. How do I declare an array of name of the array is marks? Okay, so this is how we need to declare an array. So int of marks is equal to new int of size 6. So this is how we need to declare an array. So now let's try to understand what is a collection. So a collection is also similar to arrays, which is also a group of data types. But still, let's see why we need collections and what is the advantage of collections and what is the disadvantage of collections today. Okay, so now before going to start with the collections, I should explain you there is something called object, which is super data type. Object is a super data type which is reference type, which can store any type of value. So object obj, you can actually give like this, you can give magnad or for example you can give let me create object obj, or you can even assign obj is equal to 5, or you can assign anything. So obj is equal to string string. And see now, so object is a reference data type which can store any type of data. But so it is like a reference variable object. So you need to remember, so object is something like a super object in C#, which can store any data type. So right, an object, if you create an object, so let me put here p is an object. P is an object of type object. So when you create an instance of this variable object, you can store any data type in that. Okay, so now but the only disadvantage of this, when you want to, for example I'm giving int. Okay, no, we have here, see, when I declare p is equal to Ravi, so now first time I have assigned Meghnad for p, and then I have assigned p is equal to 5. So this Meghnad will be overwritten by this 5. Next time when I assign Ravi, this 5 will be overwritten by this Ravi. So now if I print like this, if I write console.write line, so that will have now what it will print now when I do like this console.readline. So console.readline, so it will print Ravi now. So let's execute this. Let's see the output. So but this will not happen with any other objects. For example, if it is not an object data type, okay, so only one value will, yeah, correct. So when you assign some value for a variable, the recently assigned one will be stored in the variable. So it will not hold all these three at a time. it will only hold the recently assigned value. Similarly, take for example when I do int age is equal to 25, now I assign age is equal to 29, and also I assign age is equal to 50. So now when I print the value of age, only the recently assigned one will be stored in the age. So it will not store these two anymore. It will only store the recently assigned value. So the difference between other data types and the object data type is, so an integer value can only store integer values. I mean, integer variable can only store integer values. It cannot store, if you assign age is equal to Meghnad, it will throw the error straight away. It will throw the compilation error. So it will not allow you to store other than integers. See now, when I move the mouse here, cannot implicitly convert string to integer. So it is throwing an error because this is of integer. But since object is a super data type which can store any type of value. It can store string, or it can store integer, it can store an object, or it can store whatever you want. You can store inside an object data type. Okay, so now an object data type will have four methods. So when I put dot here, I'm seeing four methods. So these are called methods. So I'll also explain what are methods later, how to create methods for a class and all. So please keep in mind, we have four methods for object. I'll explain later, but you should tell me what are the method names when I ask next time. So we have dot equals, dot get hash code, dot get type, and dot toString. So we'll be using very frequently dot toString, but also the other three also keep in mind. I'll ask in the next class. There are four methods for an object: equals, get hash code, get type, and toString. Okay. Now I'll tell you what is the use of that equals. Now, say for example, I have object P and I have another object Q. Object Q is equal to Ravi. Now, if I want to check the equality of these two, I can actually do if. I can write here p dot toString or toString equals q dot toString. So I can do like this. I'm just converting that to toString, and I'm just writing here console dot write line equal. So I'm not sure. I'm sure we have not used toString before. So else console dot write line not equal. Okay, so till now we would have used convert.toString. So wherever we want to convert to integer, so we have used convert.toInt 32, and we have written console.readline. Okay, so now if you want to convert toString, so there are two ways to do. One is you can do convert.toString and then you can put p here. And you can check equal to convert dot toString. You can put Q here. So you can check this way. Inside this if condition, you could have actually written this, or you can also do p dot toString. So p dot toString is equal to q dot toString. So what will be the answer now? If I execute this, what will be the answer? Do you think these two are equal or not equal? So these two are not equal, because P is Meghnad and Q is Ravi. So when I execute this, I'll see the output as not equal. Okay, now what will be the output when I change it to Meghnad? So it will be equal. So let me execute this. Okay, so now for that purpose, what we have is, we can actually use the inbuilt method which you have, P dot equals. Okay, so P dot equals Q. So let me execute this. See the difference? So we can use this inbuilt methods. So now let me quickly ask question. So what are the four methods that we have for object? Can you ping me if you can recollect it? I'm sure I didn't show that for a long time, but I'll be explaining that methods later in the class. So let me see who will ping the methods. So one method is equals, And anyone remember what are the other methods? So I got the answers from Babita and Sarika. So we have equals, we have toString, and we have get hash code and get type. Perfect. So I got response from at least 3 to 4 students. So okay, so that's good. So now I'll be explaining the remaining objects in the later class. So remaining methods in the later class. For now, you should know that object is of super type. Okay, so now let's start with collections. Okay, so now the namespace which is used for collections is using system.collections. So all the collections which we are going to use down the line, we have the namespace called using system.collections. Okay, now let's see one example of a collection. So we have a collection called ArrayList. So ArrayList is a collection. So if you have any doubt whether that's a collection that belongs to collection or not, so the moment you type ArrayList, so you can see here this is the class ArrayList and this is the namespace. So this confirms that so okay, so I got a question, so I'll explain that in a while. Collections are generic. I'll explain in a while. So if you see here, we have system.collections.ArrayList. So that means your ArrayList actually belongs to which namespace? It belongs to system.collections. So that is how, for example, if you take console.readline, so console, when I type console, you can see that we have system.console. That means console belongs to system namespace. Console belongs to system namespace. All of you know that already. Similarly, when you type ArrayList, you can see that the namespace which it belongs to, ArrayList. So now system.collections.ArrayList. So ArrayList belongs to the namespace system.collections. Okay, so I'm getting questions like, what is the use of system.collections.generic? So I'll discuss in after half an hour about this. Okay, now let me declare an ArrayList and see the difference. So ArrayList is also collection of data types. So let me type ArrayList. ArrayList AL is equal to new ArrayList. So now the good thing about ArrayList is, or the advantage of ArrayList over arrays is, you don't need to mention the size when declaring. Okay, straight away you can add al.add for 54, or you can write like this al.add 95. Okay, so that is one good thing. So you don't need to mention the size of variable while declaring an ArrayList or while declaring a collection. So that is the advantage of collections over generics. So in arrays, while declaring the value, you have to mention the size, otherwise it will not take. And that disadvantage of having that way is, down the line in C# code, imagine you have some 500 lines, so you want to add one more value for the array, you have to come to the top and change the size and then add the 7th element. And then again you realize that you have to add 9th element or 10th element, you have to come to the top and you have to change the size of the array and then you have to add it. So for that reason, we have something called collections. So collections are also like collections are also group of data types, and we don't need to specify size while declaring. Okay, now when I'm adding here al.add, when I put brackets, so what is the type I'm adding here? So what is the type I'm adding here for a collection? What is the type I'm adding here? So since I'm adding an object, I'm adding a type object, so even I can add Meghnath. So this will not throw me any error. But by mistake I've added Meghnath, which is this is actually supposed to be marks 2. Okay, so this is supposed to be marks 2. So I'll tell this tip for you. So when you are changing a variable name, when you are, see, I have al here 4 places, So I don't need to modify when I want to change this variable name from AL to Max2. Okay, you just press control, hold control and dot and press enter. So you can actually rename all the places. You don't need to worry about so now I have Max already here. So let me do control Z and let me rename it to Max2. Max2. I can just put control dot. So see, now I'm just typing again. So I have AL here. Yeah. So I'll tell again. I'll tell again and again on this one, because this is very good tip which we use very frequently as a developer. I have ArrayList AL and it is totally referenced in 4 times. Now I decided to change the variable name from AL to Max2. I want to change this to Max2. So I can actually type here Max2 and press control dot enter. Okay, or so it is not changed now. I'm repeating again, Max2 and then control dot, press enter. Okay, so it will apply. So it has changed all the 4 places. So I repeat here, change the variable name and press control plus dot symbol. Okay, or if you think this is confusing, so what you can do is just change this to Max and you will see a red small underline there. So select that, it will come like this, click on this and rename AL to Max. Okay, so click on this, so that will rename to Max. Okay, so now let me rename to Max2. I'm seeing here this red line under that. When I rename it, you will see a small rectangle below that variable. So you need to click on that rectangle which you are seeing here. So just click on that rectangle. When you click on that rectangle, you will see an option called rename AL to Max2. When you select that, it will rename all the references. This is specially useful when your code is scattered and you want to rename all the places. Either you should go for search and replace, or this is the best option to do. Okay, now Max2, I want to store only Max, but by mistake I have added a string here, so this will not throw you any error. Because what is the type which you are adding for a collection? When you put add, what is the type you are adding? Is it a string or is it an integer? So it is an object. So what are the data types objects can hold? An object can hold any data type. All the data types can be held by an object. So that is the disadvantage of using collections. The disadvantage of using collections is if you try to add some data type which is not intentional, it will not throw you any error. Okay, so collections are not type safe because you are adding an object all the time. Okay, so what is the advantage of array? I mean, what is the advantage of collection over arrays? What is the advantage of collections over arrays? All of you ping me in the chat window the answer. What is the advantage of collection over arrays? Yeah, so I got response from, I'm getting response from all of you. So please ping me the answer. What is the advantage of collections over arrays? Yeah, all of you others. I'm seeing Bhavik, Jesse, Padmini, Parimala and Seema, Sarika. So I saw a response from some of you. Please ping me the answer.
Actually, I can't type the answer. I am attending the class through mobile.
Okay.
That's why. Okay.
No problem. Yeah. So for those who can type the answer, you can answer. Okay. So the advantage of collections or arrays is we need not mention the size while declaring the array. Okay, so that is the advantage. Okay, so now, so this is how we for arrays we assign the values like this: marks of 0, marks of 0, marks of 0 is equal to 97, and we assign like this: marks of 1 is equal to 100. So this is how we assign values for arrays. And how are we adding for collections? We are doing like this: marks.add, marks2.add. So using this method add, we are actually assigning the values. We are not following this way, this methodology for arrays, for collections. Okay, now if you want to do some of these two, 54 and 59, so for example, if I want to add these two, so how we can do that? So we can do like this: int sum is equal to marks of 0 plus marks of 1. So this is how you normally do if you want to add the elements of an array. Now this sum will store the 97 plus 100, so this will store 197. So now if you want to add int sum 2 is equal to, we do the same way, marks of 2 of, even you can give the same way, marks of 2 of 0 plus marks of 2 of 1, but now you cannot do this way. So what is the type of this marks 2 of 0? What is the type of this element? Is it integer? Yeah, it is an object. But what is this side? This side, it is an integer. So you cannot assign this object to an integer. That is one other drawback of using collections. So every time you have to typecast, you have to typecast when you want to store or when you want to add the number. So what you need to do here, you have to write here convert dot to int 32, okay, and then you have to write like this. Sandhya, I'm not able to hear you. Okay, you want to ask a question? Okay, ping the question. I think there is some problem with your microphone, so you can ping the question. Okay, so here you need to type okay, I'll explain that. Yeah, so here we have to write convert dot to int, okay, to int 32. I'm writing here. Okay, so this is how you have to do. So every time when you want to retrieve some integer value from the collection, you have to typecast it. So what is this converting object to value type? What is this? What do we call this one as? Is it a boxing or unboxing? So marks2 is a reference type, and I'm trying to convert that to integer. So this is called what? I saw one response. I need to see a response from all of you. Converting reference to value type, what do we call? Yeah, it is called unboxing. So every time doing like this will make you, it's not performance wise, do you think this is faster? Okay, yeah, so that is a disadvantage of collections. So now can someone tell me what are the two disadvantages of collections? The first disadvantage of collections is it's not type safe. You can add any type of data. And the second disadvantage is performance wise, since if you want to add or if you want to do any operations which you can do on value types, you have to do unboxing. Okay, so that is the second disadvantage. Okay, now I got a question saying like, can I add, so because I have to add marks.add at first place in the middle, so how can you do that? Yeah, we can do that. We have a lot of methods for collections. So I'll be explaining one by one. So I'll tell you what are the methods in the collections and how you can insert or all those things. I'll tell in some time. Okay. Now, okay. So this is about collections, and we have lot more details about collections, but keep these two in mind. With this we'll see what are the different collections we have. So the first collection which we saw is ArrayList, and you should know how to add elements into ArrayList is using .add method, and you should know how to retrieve the elements from ArrayList. It is using index, marks of 0, marks of 1, like that. Okay, so now if you want to print the elements of array, either you can go for using a for loop or you can go for using a for each loop. So we'll discuss now about what is the use of for loop and what is the use of for each loop. Now if I want to print the elements of array using for loop, so what I need to do is I need to write for int I is equal to 0, i less than or equal to what is the size currently, how many elements I have in max, how many elements I have only 2, I assigned only 2, so I need to give less than or equal to 3 or less than or equal to 2. What do I need to give here? So let me give less than or equal to 2 i plus plus, and I need to give here console.writeline. I need to give here max of I. So do you think this will throw me any error, or do I need to correct somewhere? So as I said before, array index starts from 0. So what do I need to give here? I less than or equal to, or i less than 2 I need to give, because array starts from 0, so it will print marks of 0 and it will come back again I value 1 less than 2, it will print marks of 1 and I value becomes 2, so 2 less than 2 it will come outside. Okay, so this is how we need to write to print the values. So now let's try to understand what is a for each loop. So using a for loop, for sure you should know that what is the size of this array, but when you are using for each loop, see now, for each int mark in marks, so you can actually do like this. So now you don't need to worry about this. So console.writeline, you can just type mark. Okay so here I'm just writing for each int m, or I can just put int m. So let me rename to m, control dot, I replaced the mark with m. So for each int m in marks, console.writeline m. So now what will happen is, it will take the first element from marks and print it. It will take the second element from marks and print it. It will take the third element, if it is there, it will print it. So you don't need to worry about the size. So when you are using, can we use for each to get the values in regular array? What do you mean by this question, Padmini? Can you explain a bit?
I'm just asking, like, if I need to get a value of a mark of 0, and I need to calculate something. So in a regular array, can we use a for each loop and like the same thing, int I some value in marks?
No. Because when you are using, okay, so I'll mute you. Just a second. Okay, so that's a good question actually. So here, if you see, when you are using for each loop, it will take element by element, first element, second element, third element. But when you are proceeding with that, it will not have any idea that what is the number of that element, what is the index of that element. So but the advantage of using for each loop is you need not worry about the size. So when you are using for each loop, the good thing is you don't need to worry about the size. So now when I have some 1000 lines of code, and now I need to write a for loop to print the elements of array, I should go to the top of the file, and I should see that what is the size, how many number of elements are there in the array. So why should you care for it? So you should not care for it. So you can just simply write for each loop. So do you think all of you agree with me that writing a for each loop is 100 times better than writing a for loop? Okay, so it's very much better, especially when you are using arrays and collections. Please go for using for each. You don't need to worry about size of an array, or even you don't need to. So now let me run this. So when it can't see at indexes, how will it know the last value? Okay, so it will take element by element. So for example, how for each loop will work is, let me explain how for each loop will work. So it'll have like this. Okay, now I have here 97, and I have here 80, and I have here 76, and I have here 92. So for each element, for each, so what it'll do, m in max. So first it'll take first element, and it'll store in m. Next, second element, store in m. Third element, store in m. Fourth element, store in m. And it'll see is the next element is available or not. If it is not available, it'll stop there. Okay, so it'll keep on printing element by element, and then it'll stop somewhere. That's all. Now let's try to execute this program. So I'll comment all the unnecessary code which I have used before. So I have commented this. Now let's try to run that. So let me comment this as well. So let me run this. See, we are seeing 97, 100, all are 4, all zeros. Why it is showing all zeros is because you have actually given here new int. Okay, so when you write like this, new int 6, so when you write like this, new int of 6, so it will actually declare array which will have, for example, now let's see here, it will declare an array like this with all the values as zeros. 0 0 0 0 0. Okay, so that is the use of writing new like this. When you instantiate value with new int of 6, so what it will do is it will initialize all the values to zeros, and then it will assign, now when you assign 97, it will first print 97, and then it will print 100. Okay, and then it will store 100 here. The remaining values are zeros. Okay, so that is the reason why we are getting here all zeros. Okay, so now when I use a for each loop for max 2, see the difference, I'm using here max 2. Now you will not see any zeros, you will see exactly two elements, 54 and 95. That is the advantage of using collections. So you will not see all the zeros like how you are seeing in arrays. So let me run this and see the difference. We'll see 54 and 95. See, now I'm saying 54 and 95. Okay, so anyway, but still, if you have six subjects in your code, you would have already added the values for six subjects. See, now like this you would have added, so you would have added like this all the subjects, 2, 3 and 4 and 5. Okay, and then you would have written the subject marks here like 89 76 92 93 45 88. So you would have already had like this, and then you will type here for each m in max, you will print it. So it'll for each loop will take care of number size. You don't need to mention the size here. That is the advantage of using for each loop. Okay, so now someone is asking question, int array memory is allocated. Int array memory is allocated to size. What is that? Yeah. So now when you declare an array, of size 6. So what happens is, inside the computer, so it'll continuously allocate the memory. For example, let me show you. So imagine you have your computer memory like this. Okay, so when you declare an array int 6, so what happens is total memory it will allocate. Total memory required for this integer, what is the total size required for this 6 elements of max? You can bring me what will be the size of max in memory? It is 24, because each integer takes 4 bytes and 6 fours are 24. So it'll allocate for first element, for second element, for third element, for fourth element, for fifth element, and for sixth element. So like this, it'll allocate 24 bytes sequentially. Okay, so sequentially it'll allocate in the memory. Okay, so now. Okay, so I think I'll just summarize very quickly. So arrays are collection of similar data types, and when you are declaring an array, you have to mention size of it. Now, collections are also similar to arrays, which are collection of data types, but not necessarily similar data types. Okay, so collections will be adding an object. Every time when we add, we'll be adding an object. So, okay. Now, collections are not type safe because you can add any type of data into it. So by mistake, if you have added Meghna into a collection of marks, it will not throw you any compilation error. And the second thing is, when you are using collections, you have to do typecasting very frequently, because since it is an object, when you try to assign that value to an integer, you have to typecast it. You have to do convert.toint and all. Okay. And the good thing about both arrays and collections is you can use a for each loop instead of using a for loop. You can use a for each loop for each int m in max. You can just print the values. Okay. So is it clear now, all of you? Okay, so I'm getting a question. What if I want to take values dynamically for array list, say 100? Again, we have to use for each. So, what if I want to take values dynamically for array list, say 100? So, for example, I want to read 100 values into an array list. Okay, so see here. So let's remove all this code. Okay. So now I have an array list. Array list AR is equal to, or array list marks is equal to new array list. And here for int i is equal to 1, I less than or equal to I less than or equal to 10, I plus plus, I have to add. So here I want to add 10 marks into array list. So what I can do here, console.writeline enter marks. Okay, and here I can simply write here marks.add. Okay, I can actually write here even I can actually put here obj object o is equal to, I can write here console.readline, I can simply add marks.add o. Okay, so now if I want to print the values, while printing I can simply use for loop. See, now here I'm giving 10 because I want to add 10 marks, but while printing I don't need to write a for loop. I can write a for each loop for each int m in marks, I can simply write here console.writeline m. Okay, so here let me give something like console.readline write line printing the marks below. Okay, so let me run this. So okay, I missed a semicolon there. I'm getting an error, so let me add that and let me run this. Okay, so enter marks. So let me enter 10 marks here very quickly. So 1, 2, 3, okay, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and one more marks, 10. Now I have added 10 marks using for loop. Now if I'm printing here using for each loop, see, now printing the marks below, and for each mark, for each m, okay, now I got an exception. Why I got the exception, you have to tell me now. So what is actually every element in marks is what? What type is that? Every element in marks, inside marks, it is not integer. It is not integer. I told already, in a collection, it is not a value type. It is an object. So the mistake which I did here is I need to put here.
H2K Infosys provides world-class online IT training, staffing, and software testing solutions to customers worldwide. H2K Infosys, how we are different from our competitors. 100% job-oriented training, hands-on project work, cloud test lab, resume preparation and review, mock interviews, robust syllabus, one-time fee and lifetime access to classes, access to recorded sessions of live classes. H2K Infosys has won the trust of thousands of students worldwide. For a free demo class, visit us at h2kinfosys.com.